Hi, in this tutorial, I will give an overview of how you can use Python for control engineering. First, I will introduce some of my Python resources. I have made a textbook called Python for Control Engineering. In addition, I have made other Python resources and textbooks, Python Programming, Python for Science and Engineering, and Python for Software Development. You find these textbooks and other Python resources like videos, examples, etc. on my webpage at this location. So let's go back to the contents of this tutorial. I will give an introduction to control engineering. I will introduce some of the Python libraries that is useful in control engineering applications like the NumPy, Matplotlib, SciPy, and especially the submodule called scipy.signal, and the Python library called Python Control Systems Library. This library contains lots of functions for control engineering applications. I will provide lots of Python examples. So this tutorial or video is just the beginning. I will provide lots of other tutorials that goes more in the depth of the different topics I will cover in this video. Transfer functions, state-space models, frequency response, PID control, stability analysis, using frequency response in stability analysis, how tutorials for logging measurement data, control system in Python, exemplified by using some small-scale industrial processes and simulators, DAC systems, etc. Let's start with some of the Python libraries that is necessary or at least very handy to use when creating control applications with Python. So we have the basics library, the NumPy and the Matplotlib. So the NumPy contains lots of features for handling arrays, etc. That is useful in control engineering applications. The Matplotlib is the standard library for creating plots and charts. And if you have installed Python using the Anaconda distribution, these packages should already be installed on your computer. Next, the SciPy. Also, the SciPy library is included with the Anaconda distribution. And especially the submodule called .signal contains lots of features and functions for dealing with the control engineering applications. The next library I will recommend is Python Control Systems Library. This is an additional Python package that implements basic features and functions for analysis and design of control systems. For those who are familiar with MATLAB, this Python library is very similar to the MATLAB control system toolbox. I will use both the SciPy signal and the Python control systems library in this tutorial. If you need more information about the SciPy, you can take a closer look at the documentation, and the same for the Python control systems library. You will find lots of documentation on their homepages. So let's start with the basic regarding control engineering. Typically, we have a control system like this example. We have a process that we want to control. And in order to control the process, we need to have a controller. Typically, we need or use a PID controller. That's the most used controller today. The PID controller, and typically we need to measure some of the states or variables in the process using some kind of sensors. Typically we need to filter these signals using a low pass filter, and then based on that we can find the proper control signal that we send to the process through one or more actuators. So this is basically a basic control system. So then, as we see in this figure, we have the R, the reference signal, or the reference value, or the set point. This is the value that we want that the process should stay on. It could be a temperature value, it could be pressure, it could be a level in a level tank, etc. And then we have Y, which is the measurement value, which is the output of the process or the output from the sensors. Then we have E, this is the error between the reference value, the value we want that the process should be on, and the measurement value. So that's the feedback in this loop. We have the reference value and the measured value, and then the error between the reference value and the measured value is the input to the controller. And we could have some disturbance or noise to the system or the process that we need to deal with. And then finally we have U, which is the control signal from the controller that goes to the actuators and the process. So here you see the basic PID algorithm. As mentioned, this PID controller is the most used controller in control systems today. That's because this PID controller is very easy to use, it's easy to implement, and it has very few tuning parameters. It has three tuning parameters. It has KP, which is the proportional gain, TI, the integral time, and TD, the derivative the time. So this PID controller consists of three parts: the proportional part, the integral part, and the derivative part. And each those parts and combined makes a very great controller for controlling all kind of processes. So let's start with some Python examples. I will start with the dynamic systems and the differential equations. So a dynamic system is the heart of any control system. And the purpose with a control system is to control a dynamic system. It could be an industrial process. It could be an airplane. It could be a self-driven car. Typically we have control systems everywhere in today's society. And typically we need or want to start with a mathematical model of such a dynamic system. And the mathematical model of such a system could be a differential equation, it could be a transfer function, or it could be a state space model. And then we will use the mathematical model to create a simulator of the control system. So let's start with a first order dynamic system. Typically, a first order dynamic system can be described by the following differential equation, or we can put it on this form, where in this case T is the time constant and K is the gain of the process. And this differential equation will be used throughout this tutorial in different applications and examples. And this differential equation represents a first order dynamic system. And also we can perform a step response for this system. So we have this dynamic system here, in this case this first order system. We can apply a step on the input signal, typically the control signal, and then we can see the behavior and performance of the system on the output. So this is called a step response. We can solve this differential equation using Laplace and assume we apply a step signal in the input signal. Then we can find the solution to these differential equations to be the following algebraic equation. So we will start by simulate this differential equation by implementing this equation in Python. So let's implement this system in Python, I will use the spider editor. The spider editor is a very good editor, and it's part of the Anaconda distribution. It's very similar to the MATLAB environment for those who are familiar with MATLAB. So on the left side here, you have the code editor, and you can just run your applications or your code by clicking on this run button. So here I have implemented the solution for this differential equation. So this is the equation I showed you. This is the solution for the differential equation, where k is the process gain and t is the time constant of the system. I just set k equals to 3 and t equals to 4 in this example. I need to create a array of t elements that we will use in the simulation. So this is just an array of t elements from 0 to 30 seconds. And the increment value is 0.1. And then I'll use one of the built-in functions in the NumPy library, this arrange function, which is very handy to use. Then I just implement the equation like this. And then I can use this matplotlib in order to plot the results of the simulations. So then I just use the plot function. Then of course I can add some title, x-label, y-labels, add some grids, etc. So let's just run this example by clicking on this run button. Let's find the plot. Yeah, so here you've got the results from this application. So this is actually the step response of this dynamic system, this first order dynamic system. So we apply a step in the input signal, the control signal, and then this will be the results of the simulation. So this is the step response for this first order dynamic system. And we have implemented in Python using these few lines of code. So we had this, we started with this first order dynamic system represented by this differential equation. And then we solved this differential equation using Laplace. And we found the following algebraic equation, which is the solution for the differential equation. And then we implemented the following Python code for simulating this system. So we just implemented this equation here in Python, and then we plotted it using this matplot library. And then we got the following result, simulation results, using k equals to 3 and t equals to 4. Some comments on this example. We have many different options when it comes to simulation of a dynamic system. We can solve the differential equations and then implement the algebraic solution and plot it, like we did in this previous example. And this solution may work for simple systems, but for more complicated systems, it may be difficult to solve the differential equation or differential equations by hand. Because this was a very basic and simple differential equations, but typically we may have more complicated differential equations, and we may have multiple differential equations. So then other better ways to solve this and simulate this dynamic system is to use one of the built-in ODE solvers in Python, or we can make a discrete version of the system and simulate the discrete system, and or we can convert the differential equation and implement and simulate the transfer functions of the system. And we will demonstrate all these examples in this tutorial. So let's dig into these examples. So here I will present an example for the same system. So we have this differential equation, but now I will use the one of the built-in ODE solvers. Actually, it's not built in into the basic Python, but it's part of the SciPy library. And if you have installed Python through the Anaconda distribution, you could consider it as built-in because it's already installed. So we have this differential equation. We will use the same process parameters, k and t, k equals to 3 and t equals to 4. So this is the process gain and this is the time constant of the system. And we will implement this system using the built-in solver, which is part of the SciPy library. So here is the Python code for this example. I have used the SciPy library and the integrate submodule of the SciPy library because this library includes the built-in ODE solvers. So in this case I have used the built-in ODE int solver, and the input to this solver is the function itself, and the function itself has been created here in a Python function. So this is the name of the function. I just called it system first order, and the input to this function is y, t, the model parameters k, t, and the control signal. And then I've just implemented the differential equation inside this Python function. So this is the first argument in the solver. Then the initial values, which is set here, t, and t is an array of t values that are used in the simulations, and then this additional argument, which is the model parameters k, t, and y, u. So that's the built-in ODE solver, which needs to have Python functions where we implement the system or the differential equation like this. And then the output of the solver is the x values, and then we can use the matplotlib in order to plot the final results, which is in this case t versus x. So let's just run this program. So here you get the x values, and then you get this plot, which is the same as the previous plot. The result and the solution to this differential equation. So this is how you use the built-in ODE solvers in Python. So in the next example I will show how you can use discretization in order to solve this system. So here we start with the differential equation for our system, our first order system, and then we can use, for instance, Euler forward method on this differential equation. So we just replace this one with this approximation, and then applying this approximation we get the following results, and if we just multiply etc. we get this final discrete differential equation. So y k plus 1 equals to 1 plus ts a, all this multiply with the current value of y. And then we have the control part plus ts multiply with b and the current control value. So let's use Python in order to implement this discrete version of the differential equation. So here you see the Python code for this example. It's very similar to previous examples, but instead of first solving the differential equation and then implement and plot the algebraic solution, or using the built-in one of the built-in ODE solvers, we have made a discrete version of the differential equation. So here is the discrete version of the differential equation. It is implemented inside a for loop, and the model parameters is the same as in the previous example, the simulation parameters as well. In addition, I have created an empty array which I use to store the y value in each iteration inside this for loop. And then when the for loop is finished, I just set the length of the simulation here, n, which is this, I just set a stop time, so this simulation should last for 30 seconds. Then I find a number of iteration in the for loop by dividing the t stop, the end time here, by the sampling time. So then I find this number of iterations that I use in this for loop. When the for loop is finished, I just plot the simulation results as in the previous examples. So let's just run this example by clicking the run button. And as you see, you get the same results as in the previous examples. So far we started with this mathematical model of the dynamic system, which is in this example was just a first order system. And then we started to solve the differential equation, and then plotted the solution using Python. Then in the next example we used the built-in ODE solvers in Python, and then in the third and last example we made a discrete version of the differential equation, and then we implemented the discrete version in Python and simulated the discrete version. Then the next step would be to create and use a transfer function of the dynamic system, and then after that we should show how we can use the state space model. So let's start creating some transfer functions with Python. First, some introduction to transfer functions. So transfer functions are a model form based on the Laplace transform. So in order to use and understand transfer functions, you should recall your knowledge about Laplace transformations from mathematics courses. So transfer functions are very useful when analyzing and design linear systems. We can create transfer functions in Python both using the scipy.signal module, or we can use the Python control systems library. So both these libraries can be used for creating transfer functions, manipulating transfer functions, and to simulate transfer functions. So here you see a first order transfer function. So a first order transfer function is given like this, where k is the gain and t is the time constant. As you know from previous example, we started with this differential equation of a first order system. So in time domain we have this differential equation, and in the Laplace domain we have this similar transfer function. So these two are two different model of the same system. This is a differential equation and this is the transfer function of the same system. So we can find the transfer function from the differential equation using Laplace. We will not show the details here, but that will be shown in other videos where I go in more details about transfer functions. But assume we have this transfer function, then we can see that the input signal in this case is U, which is here, and the output signal is y. So the transfer function is a representation of the system from the input to the output. And we can also use inverse Laplace in order to find the solution for the differential equation, as we have shown earlier in one of the previous examples. So now, in the next example, we will use Python in order to implement this transfer function, and then we will see if we get the same results as in the previous examples. So here you see the step response of this first order system. Then we have this differential equation, and then typically 63% of the total response gives the time constant t, and then assume you have a step signal in the control signal, which is u, then the final steady state response will be k multiplied with u in this case. So here you see the Python code for how we can implement the transfer function for our system, because in our previous system we used this, and we used k equals to 3 and the time constants equal to 4. And then we can implement the transfer function like this. We're using the NumPy library in order to create an array of the numerator and an array of the denominator. And then we can use, in this case, I have used the control library, Python library. Then there is a built-in function called tf for transfer function. It has two arguments, the numerator and the denominator, like this. So we just create first the numerator using a NumPy array, and then the denominator using a NumPy array. And then we just use the tf function. Then we can use the print command in order to print it to the console window. And then next we can use the another built-in function in the control library, namely the step underscore response function, and the input to this one is just this transfer function. And then we can plot it as we as done in the previous examples. So let's implement this code in our Python editor. So now we are back in the Spider editor. I have the code for the example here. I have the numerator and the denominator as a NumPy array, and then I use the tf function, and then finally the step response function in order to plot the simulation results. So let's just run this example, and as you see, we get the same results as in the previous examples. I just want to make one small adjustment here in order to improve the code quality. We can set k equals to 3 here, and then instead of 3 we just use k, and then the t equals to 4, the time constant, and then use t here. Then we can easily change k and t on top here without changing the rest of the code. So let's just run it once more, and as you see, we get of course the same results. So this is how we implement and simulate a transfer function in Python. In the next example, we will implement a state space model in Python. So here you see a general state space model on a general form. So x dot equals to ax plus bu, and y equals to cx plus du, where a, b, c, and d are matrices, and x dot, y, x, and u are vectors. So a state space model is a structured form of representation of a set of differential equations. And state space models are very useful in control theory and design, because it's a very compact form, and you could have a lots of differential equations that are converted to this simple state space form. You can create and use state space models both in SciPy and in the Python control systems library. So just assume we have this basic example. We have two differential equations and y equals to x1. And how can we put these differential equations on this compact state space form? Well, so we set up a vector of x1 and x2 like this, and then the same here, x1, x2, which is a vector of the variables, and then based on that we find the A matrix. Since x1 dot equals to x2, then we have 0 here and 1 here, and here in the second equation x2 dot equals to minus x2, that's why we have a minus here, plus u, and then we have 1 here. and y equals to x1, and we have the C matrix with 1 here and 0 here. So basically, this is the state space form of these differential equations, where we have the A matrix, the B matrix, the C matrix, and in this case the D matrix is just 0. And then we have the X vector, which consists of x1 and x2. So we want to implement a state space model of the same differential equation as we have used in the previous examples, namely y dot equals to 1 about t minus y plus ku, which is a first order differential equation. So then this differential equation can be implemented on state space form like this. So we have x1 dot equals to the same differential equation as I just showed you, and then I set y equals to x1. So this line and this line together is the same differential equation as I just showed you, which we have used in all the examples so far. And in order to make a state space model of this, I just set x2 dot equals to 0, and then we get the final state space model. Here is the A matrix. We have x1 and x2. We have the B matrix. We have the C matrix, and y equals to x1, so we just set 1, 0, like this. And then we can easily implement the state space model. In this case, I have used the scipy.signal library. So here is the implementation of the state space model. I just define the matrices A, B, C, and D like this, and then I can use the state space function of this scipy.signal library, and the input to this function is just these matrices A, B, C, and D. And then we can simulate the system using the built-in step function, and the input to this function is the state space model, which we have defined here, and the initial values, which is in this case is just an array of two elements, x1 and x2, and then finally the t array, which we have defined here, which has been done in the same manner as the previous examples. So let's go to our Python editor in order to implement and simulate this example. So here you see the Python code for the implementation of the state space model. Imported the scipy.signal library. In addition, as in the previous example, I have used the matplotlib for plotting and the NumPy library. Here we define the matrices A, B, C, and D like this, and then we use, since I have scipy.signal and just created an alias called sig, I just use sig dot and then the state space function with the inputs A, B, C, D like this. And then I can use the step function, which has the input state space model, the initial values, and a T array. And then I just plot it using the matplot library as in the previous examples. So let's just run this simulation. And as you see, of course, we get the same results as in the previous examples. This is the simulation of the first order differential equation. We can also easily assume, now we have implemented the state space model, we can easily find the transfer function. We can just do like this, h equals to sys dot 2 tf, like this, and then just using the built-in function that converts the state space model to a transfer function like this. And then instead of the state space model, we can use the transfer function in the step function like this, and then we can simulate the system. And now we are simulating the transfer function instead of the state space model, and as you see, get the same results as using the state space model, and we get the same result as in the previous example where we implemented the transfer function directly. So this is how we can use Python in order to implement state space models, transfer functions, and we can easily convert between the state space model and the transfer function, or vice versa. The next topic I will cover in this tutorial is frequency response. So the frequency response is an important tool for analysis and design of signal filters, and for analysis and design of control systems. And the frequency response can be found from the transfer function model. So we already know how to implement a transfer function in Python. And also we have the Bode diagram, which gives a simple graphical overview of the frequency response for a given system. And the Bode diagram is an excellent tool for analyzing the stability properties of a given control system. So we can implement frequency response on Bode diagrams, both using the SciPy library and the Python control systems library. So let's start with the SciPy library. So assume you have the following transfer function, which we want to implement in Python, and then we want to plot a Bode diagram of the transfer function like this. So let's implement this example in our Python editor. So here you see the Python code for this example. I will not go into too much details, because I will go into more details in a later tutorial about transfer functions. But basically here I've used the SciPy library. So we start by defining the transfer function like this. So we need to define the numerator and the denominator. In this example we have a complex numerator and a complex denominator, so in addition I use this built-in function, which is part of the NumPy library. When the total numerator and the total denominator has been created, we can use the transfer function in this SciPy library, and the input is just the numerator and the denominator. And then we need to create some frequencies before we can start creating the Bode plot. And in order to create the Bode plot, we can use this built-in Bode function, which is part of this SciPy library. And the input to this function is the transfer function and an array of frequencies, which I have created here. Then I can create two plots. One, I use a subplot here. So in the first subplot, we create, typically we create the magnitude plot, and in the second subplot we create the phase plot, because this Bode plot consists of two plots, one magnitude plot and one phase plot. So let's just run this example, and here you see the final results. The Bode plot consists of first the magnitude plot, and then in the lower subplot, we have this phase plot. So that's how you implement a transfer, a quite advanced transfer function in Python, and implement a Bode plot using this SciPy library. In the next example, I will use this Python control systems library. It's a little bit easier to create a Bode plot in the Python control system library. So here we have the plot using the SciPy library. Let's just change the code in order to use the Python control systems library instead. So instead of SciPy, I want to use the Python control systems library. So then I just type import control like this. We have the same transfer function, so instead of this one, I need to use control dot tf, which I used previously, numerator and denominator like this. we don't need to use these subplots. We just remove this part. We don't need these frequencies. We can use them, but now I will just show the most simple way of implement frequency response and a body plot in Python. So instead of this one, we just use the control library. So control dot body, and the input to this one is the transfer function. And typically we also want to have the scale on the y-axis in the magnitude plot in the decibel. So I just set dB equals to true like this. So basically, and also now we don't need to use the matplot library, so I can remove that one as well. So basically, this was the previous example using the scipy.signal consisting of 41 lines of code, and now I'm using the Python control systems library instead, and the code is now only 17 lines. So let's just run this example. Yeah, of course, body should it say here. Let's just run it, and as you see, we get the same results using this Python control systems library as we did in this previous example where we used this SciPy library. So this is the result from the using the SciPy library, and this is the result using this Python control systems library. So it's up to you which Python library you want to use, but typically when dealing with the transfer functions, body plot, frequency response, and other control topics, this Python control system library has more features that is suitable for analyzing and design of control systems. So now we have implemented the dynamic system in different ways. We have used the differential equation, we have used a transfer function, we have used a discrete version of the differential equation, we have used the state space model, and now it's time to create and implement a control system. So typically we will use a PID controller when implementing the control system. And the purpose with the control system is to control the dynamic system, and the dynamic system in our case is just a first order system. And that system could be an industrial process, it could be an airplane, it could be a self-driven car, etc. Typically we have control systems everywhere in today's society. So here you see a basic control system. You have a process, and that is the process we want to control. And in order to control the process, we need to have a controller, and typically we need to use a PID controller. We have more advanced controllers like MPC, etc. We will not focus on those advanced controllers in this tutorial. We will use the basic PID controller because the PID controller is easy to implement and easy to use and easy to understand, and it has also few tuning parameters. So basically it's easy to implement a PID controller. And the results is also very good using a PID controller. So basically, this is what we call a feedback loop. We have the process, we measure the output of the process, and then we have a reference signal. This is the signal, the value that we want the process to stay at. It could be a level in a water tank, it could be a temperature in another process, it could be a pressure level, etc. So this is the wanted value, the reference value. And we compare this wanted value, the reference value, with the measured value. And then typically we will get an error. And then this error between the reference signal and the measured signal will be an input to the controller, in this case a PID controller, and then the PID controller will calculate a control signal that is given as an input to the process. And then the process will act on this control signal, and then a new output signal will be given, and then you go back and compare the reference value with the new measured value, etc. And this goes into a loop. So here you see an overview of the PID algorithm that we are going to use and implement in Python. So how the output of the PID controller is the control signal that goes into the process. And the PID algorithm consists of three parts, namely the proportional part, the integral part, and the derivative part. And then we have the following tuning parameters. We have three tuning parameters in a PID controller. We have KP, which is the proportional gain, TI, which is the integral time, in typically in seconds, and then we have TD, which is the derivative time, typically in seconds. And in order to implement this equation in Python, we typically need to make a discrete version of this algorithm. So as shown in the previous example, where we used the Euler method in order to make a discrete version of the differential equation of the process, in the same way we can make a discrete version of the PID controller. I will not go into details here, but finally we will get the following discrete version of the differential of the PID controller. In general we have the PID controller, but in this tutorial I will only implement the proportional part and the integral part, and I will set this derivative part to zero. So basically we will not implement a PID controller in this case, we will only implement a PI controller. So this is the algebraic equation for the PI controller, where in this case this E is the error between the reference signal and the measured signal. So in the previous example we implemented the discrete version of our first order process, which was given as this differential equation, and the discrete version, as shown earlier, is this equation, which we have already implemented. And now we have found the discrete version of our controller, in this case a PI controller. So basically, in order to create a control system, we need to implement the discrete version of the process and the discrete version of the controller. So let's see how we can implement this in Python. So here you see the Python code for this control system. We have the model parameters, and we have the simulation parameters, the sampling time, how long the simulation should last. In this case I just set 20 seconds. Of course you can set a longer time here, but just in this demonstration I will not set too long time, because we don't have so much time when showing it in this tutorial. And here I set the initial value. Here, inside a for loop, the main program is implemented. Here I have the discrete version of the process, the discrete differential equation. And here we have the discrete implementation of our controller, the PI controller in this case. So here we find first the error between the reference value and the measured value. And then based on that, the controller calculates a new control signal, UK, which is an input in this discrete version of the process. And then in the next iteration, it goes on, finding a new error, calculating a new output of the controller, which is fed into the process, etc. And then when the simulation is finished, we will plot the results using this this matplot library. And here also we set the PI parameters. We have the KP. I just set some random values here. KP, I set it just 0.5, and the integral time, I just set it to 5 seconds. And of course, we need to set our reference value, the wanted value we want the process to stay on. I set some initial arrays for the error and the control signal as well. So let's just run this example. And as you see, we get two plots. In plot or figure one, we get the process output. In this case, I set the reference value to be 5. And as you see, after some time, it goes into and stay on the reference value when it goes into steady state. So the reference value is set to 5 in this case. And here in figure number 2, we have the control signal. So this is the U, and you see in the beginning it's changing a lot. And here it's when the process reaches the reference value. We don't have so much control signal. So it's in the beginning when it's reaching the reference value, we see a large variation in the control signal. So let's just change the reference value. We could change it to 8 or something. And let's just run the simulation once more. And as you see, now I can just change the plot here. It goes from 0 to 8. I can just change it from 0 to 10 or something. And run it once more. Let's just run it once more. And then we have this plot. And as you see, after some initial, it goes into the reference value, which is in this case is set to 8. So this is basically how you create a control system using Python. We need to implement a discrete version of the process. So this is a mathematical discrete representation of the process. And these two lines is the controller. And we put all these into a for loop. And then typically we can get two plots like this. One plot for the process value and another plot for the control signal. In the final part of this tutorial, I will check the stability of the control system. So we can check the stability of a control system using different methods. I will shortly demonstrate some methods here in this tutorial. For more details, I refer to other tutorials where I go more in depth on the different topics that I cover in this tutorial. And first, we can use the poles in order to check the stability of the control system. So basically, we have a stable system, a so-called asymptotically stable system, and the poles are in the left plane of the complex plane. We have a so-called marginally stable system if we have poles on the imaginary axis in the complex plane. And we have an unstable system if the poles are in the left half of the complex plane. You can also use the step response. So if the step response go to a certain value, we have asymptotally stable system. If we have a signal like this, then the system will not stabilize on a certain value in steady state. You will have a marginally stable system. And if the step response goes to endless, we will have an unstable system. And also we can use the frequency response. In the frequency response, we have what we call VC and V180. I will not go into too much details on these frequencies, but when VC is less than V180, we have an asymptotically stable system. When VC equals to V180, we have a marginally stable system. And we have an unstable system when this VC is larger than V180. So here we see our control system, which I will demonstrate and implement in Python. So we have, as in previously, we have this PI controller, which we have implemented. In the previous example, in our control application, we implemented a discrete version of the PI controller. Typically in stability analysis, we need to use transfer functions. So this is the transfer function for the PI controller. And here you see the transfer function for the process, which we have shown earlier. And typically, in order to measure the process value, we need to have a sensor or a measurement. So I have also added a transfer function for the measurement. And also in real systems, we typically need to have a low pass filter in order to remove noise from the measured value. So I have also introduced here a transfer function for a low pass filter. And in stability analysis, we typically need the following transfer functions, the so-called loop transfer function, which is just all the transfer functions in the loop. It could be just the controller and the process, but in this case, we have the controller, the process, the sensor, and the filter. So we have the transfer function for the controller, the transfer function for the process, the transfer function for the sensor or the measurement, and transfer function for the low pass filter. So that's the loop transfer function. The other transfer function we use in stability analysis is the so-called tracking transfer function, which is defined as this transfer function, where we have in the numerator we have L, which is the loop transfer function, and in the denominator we have N plus L, which is the same loop transfer function. So we will implement both the loop transfer function and the tracking transfer function in Python. So here you see the Python code for this example. So I will go to the Spider editor and implement this Python code in my Python editor. So here you see the Python code for this example. Using the NumPy library and the matplot library for plotting and the control library for the control specific features. So we start by implementing the transfer function for the process using this TF function, and then we implement the transfer function for the PI controller. We implement the transfer function for the measurement or the sensor, and we implement the transfer function for the low pass filter. And then finally we can implement the loop transfer function, and then we can just use the built-in series function, which is part of this control library. And the input to this is all the transfer function in our control loop, which is transfer function for the controller, for the process, for the measurement, and for the filter. And then finally, the tracking transfer function. Then you can use the feedback function, which is part of the control library. And then the input will be L and just comma 1 for the feedback. Then we can find the step response for the feedback system or the control system. Then we just use the built-in step response function, and the input is just the tracking transfer function. We can find the Bode diagram using this Bode function which we have used earlier, and the input to this one is this loop transfer function L. And then we want to find the poles. In this case I also find the zeros, but mainly we want to find the poles which are used in the stability analysis of the feedback system. So we can use the PCMap function. This function plots the poles in the imaginary plane, and the input to this function is just the tracking transfer function, and we can use functions for finding the poles and the zeros, and the input is the same tracking transfer function. Then we can find the stability margins and the so-called crossover frequencies, which is these VC and V180, using this built-in margin function, which is part of this control library. And the input to this function is the loop transfer function L. Typically, and using this one, we want or need to convert it to decimal using this basic formula. So let's just run this example. And this example gives three different plots. So in figure one, we have the step response, where the input was this tracking transfer function. And as you see, in steady state, it goes to one, which indicates that we have a stable system. In the next figure, we have the poles. And as you see, the poles are these crosses. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4 poles. And all of them are in the left plane, in the imaginary plane, indicating this is a stable system. And finally, in this figure number two, we have the frequency response and the Bode diagram. And as you see, both from the plot and from the calculations done in and shown in the console window, we have this VC and V180. And as mentioned earlier, if VC is smaller than V180, we have a stable system. So based on this basic analysis of the stability of the control system, where we have implemented the tracking transfer function and the loop transfer function, where we have found the frequency response and the Bode diagram for this control system, we see that the control system is stable. So finally, so let's see what happens when we increase this KP to, let's say, just 2 or something, and let's run the Python program. And now you see a totally different results. The step response for the tracking transfer function, we see that the values go to endless, meaning we have an unstable system. We have the poles on the right half of the complex plane, indicating we have an unstable system. And finally, in the frequency response and the Bode diagram, we see that VC is larger than V180, and you also see it here in the plot. This means that we have an unstable system. So by just increasing KP from 0.4 to a higher value like 2, we go from a stable system with good tracking to an unstable system. So this is how we can use Python in order to see if the system becomes stable or not before we implement the controller on the real process. So that's why we should always start with a mathematical model of the system and perform some simulations and stability analysis. And then finally, when we have found proper PI or PID parameters, then we can implement the controller on the real process. So let's summarize. So in this tutorial, I gave a short overview of different models and how we can implement the models in Python. We started with the differential equation, then we created a transfer function and implemented the transfer function in Python. Then we implemented a state space model. We used the transfer function for frequency response. We implemented a PID control system in Python. We performed some basic stability analysis. But in this tutorial, we just scratched the surface of these more advanced topics. So if you want to learn more about the different topics we covered in this tutorial, I will provide lots more videos on these topics. If you want to learn more about Python in general, I have made different Python resources and Python textbooks. And on YouTube, you find lots of Python videos. I have made four different textbooks: Python Programming, Python for Science and Engineering, Python for Control Engineering, which is a topic in this video. And finally, I have made Python for Software Development. The textbooks, also the videos, and lots of other resources are available from my webpage. So that's all. So good luck with your Python programs. Thank you.